Good evening, everyone. Thank you very much for coming here on a Saturday evening. I have a brief presentation, probably around 10 to 15 minutes, give you a little about us at Quantum, what do we do, and then a few charts on the markets as well as on the GDP growth. Then, of course, we'll follow it up with Dhirendra's talk, and then we can have a Q&A. Very briefly, at Quantum, we began our journey in 1990. As you can see over here, we began as India's first equity research company. And then from 92 to 2004, we had partnered with a variety of institutions. We also had a joint venture with Jardine Fleming from 92 to 95. I joined Ajit in 96 at Quantum, and then we applied to SEBI for a mutual fund license. We got the license around the end of 2005, and 2006 is when we launched the Quantum Long-Term Equity Fund. Since then, we have launched around 8-odd funds. In total, we have close to around 9 funds today across categories, debt, equity, gold, and then the fund of funds. We have also done things like transactions through email, WhatsApp, fax, etc. And then we launched our regular plans in 2017, after SEBI made it mandatory that the commissions which are being paid out should be declared and informed to the investors. For us, that was very important because when we launched our fund in 2006, we did not use the regular distribution platform because of lack of transparency. We know they play an important role, but for us, it was important to also ensure that the commissions which were being paid were transparently communicated to the end investor. And that happened around 2016, and we launched our fund in 2017, the regular plan. We manage close to around $2.3 billion, largely sovereign funds, pension funds out of US, Canada, and Europe. We are also registered with a lot of regulators abroad, like the SEC and the Canadian authorities, as well as in Mauritius. Fairfax owns around 49% stake in the company, and the balance is held by Ajit, myself, and the rest of the management team. Fairfax, as you know, owns the Lombard brand and is run by a very well-known gentleman called Mr. Prem Watsa. He's known as the Warren Buffett of Canada. And they took a stake in the company around 2016. On the mutual fund, we were the 29th when we started the mutual fund in 2006, but we were the first to go direct to the investor. We used online channels as well as offline, but we did not use any other platform. We just went direct to the investor. We are focused on low cost. We are also focused on solid research process. Strongly believe in a team process rather than just a star fund manager. And as we say, we are asset managers first and then asset gatherers. We don't operate purely from the point of view that we have to gather assets. We ensure that whatever assets we gather, we manage it quite well. Something about the markets. This is the P ratio of the Sensex 30. And as you can see over here, this is quite high. Currently, it's close to 30 times. 29.1 to 30 times, and it looks like it's at an all-time peak. If you really see the P ratio, it has surpassed all the prior peaks. And this is because a lot of money has come into India in the recent months. So despite the weak environment in 2018, money flow in the first 3 months of this year has been quite strong. The reason I'm putting this across since 2001 is also for you to know that the P ratios have seen enough elections, both national elections as well as state elections. But despite that, it continues to be in a particular range where you find a lot of value. And when there is euphoria, it tends to move up very sharply. And at the same time, it also gives you an opportunity by variety of events. For instance, in 2003, it was because of SARS. The entire Asian markets had come down, including India, to very attractive levels of close to 8. You again saw those kind of P ratios in 2008 when the Lehman crisis took place. So any time it comes below the average, it tends to give good returns. And the average long-term average is around 18x. So any time the P ratio is below 18, it's safe to assume that the returns will be quite good. But this is for the Sensex, and the Sensex tends to be dominated by a few stocks. So even the recent run-up is largely dominated by, say, groups like Reliance, groups like ICICI, ITC, etc. So it's not a very broad-based movement which took place in Sensex, but a few stocks which really pushed up the P/E ratio. The flow of money since 2013, a lot of that flow has gone into mid-cap and small-cap, as can be seen in this chart. And it also points to the fact that it tends to be very volatile. For instance, you can see the after the run-up from 2013 to 2017, the markets did correct, particularly in the mid-cap and small-cap space, the green line and the orange line, it came down quite sharply. So the mid-cap and small-cap, while they tend to give outsized return, it also has a problem because the more money you put behind it, it tends to move very rapidly. The moment you pull out the money, it tends to fall very rapidly. So unless you are an extremely sharp in terms of getting in and getting out, the returns sometimes may not match your expectations. So therefore, it's very important for you to have some sort of asset allocation between mid-cap, small-cap, and large-cap. Large-cap over large long periods tend to do very well, while mid-cap and small-cap, you need to have lesser proportion in your portfolio. This is the slide since 2005, and as I said, the blue line, the Sensex, which consists of large companies, it has actually done extremely well, far better than even the mid-cap and the small-cap. So therefore, it makes sense to allocate a good amount of money to the large companies and then have lower amounts in the mid-cap and small-cap, which here is represented by the yellow line and the green line. The P/E ratio has gone up is largely because of flows, because the earnings growth in India over the past few years have been weak. And as you can see in this chart, this is the Bloomberg consensus estimates. So each year, like since 2013, if you see, the expectation at the start of the year has been very high. Like for instance, over here in 2013, the EPS expectation was 1450, then it was revised down. Then the expectation got pushed to 2015 and 2016, all because when the current government, which came into existence in 2014, the expectation was reforms will lead to a lot of earnings growth. But that did not really happen. A, the corporate India was sitting on a lot of capacity, so there was a lot of depreciation and interest charges to be booked. B, there was a slowdown globally as well as in India. So the earnings which was expected at the start of each year did not really materialize across 14, 15, 16, 17, and literally till 2018. As you can see, the growth rate between 14 to 18 was probably around 6%. So what it means is while there was no earnings growth, the money flow just pushed the Sensex P ratios up. And that is always risky. If there is no earnings, the market will have patience for some time, but if the earnings don't pick up, then there could be a sell-off. But globally, what's happening is there is a lot of liquidity available. So even in this year, around December, when in the US it was announced that interest rates may not move up, the entire risk-on trade again started, meaning a lot of money started flowing into emerging markets, including India. But that's a very unpredictable event. If the US interest rates move up, it can have an impact across the globe on equities and even on India. So what can support that P/E ratio is clearly a pickup in the EPS. And we think over the next 2 years, probably that will pick up because A, corporates are operating at a very high capacity utilization now, very high in the sense compared to where they were. So it is upwards of 70% right now, which is good. And they are not announcing any new capex immediately. So what will happen is they will sweat their existing assets. So therefore, the return ratios will look better. And with no new capacity coming in, it is quite possible that they may also get some better pricing power. So all of that means that over the next 2 years, FY20, FY21 particularly, we see the EPS growth to be quite good. It may not be as high as it is expected here, which is a consensus estimates, but we do expect a compounded 16 to 17% kind of EPS growth over the next 2 years. This is a chart on the flow of money. As you can see over here, year to date in 2019, close to 47,000 crores has come into the market from FIIs. And particularly in March, it was close to around 34,000 crores, while the domestic activity has been pretty muted. So the flow of money is what to led to the price increase and therefore the PE ratios. GDP has been quite slow. This is the new series which the government had adopted a new method of calculating GDP, which is a better method. The only problem with that is we don't have a long history behind it. So therefore, we still rely on the old GDP numbers to get a sense as to what is happening in the economy. Over here, if you see the old GDP numbers, the average rate has been 6.3%. Now, this is a very important chart. If you really see from 1980 onwards, we have had around 10 governments since then. And only three have been single-party governments. The one which are in black, they are the one with single-party. The one which are in red, at the bottom, they have all been coalition governments. And the average rate has been 6.3%. The current 2014 to 18, the number is 7.4. But as I said, that 7.4 is based on the new method of calculating GDP. Many economists knock off around 150 to 200 basis point. So you could knock off around 150 basis point, and that means the GDP growth has probably been around 5.9 to 6. Which is very close to the long-term average, but nothing phenomenal. Which is fine. In a world which is growing at around 2%, India's real GDP growth at 6% is very good. And if we get our act together on the infrastructure, then probably we will grow at a much faster pace. But at this point in time, even a 6% GDP growth is good. The reason I'm saying this is very important is we have seen so many elections. There have been national elections, there have been number of state elections, there have been anti-incumbency, there have been pro-incumbency, there have been coalitions, there have been floods, famines, high oil prices, low inflation, high inflation, droughts, anything you could think of, we have seen all kind of problems, but still we have grown at that average of 6.3%. And that is reflected in the way the Sensex has done. If you see at the extreme bottom, those are the annualized return of BSE 30. And you can see here, barring 98-99, where we had a short stint government, where the markets declined by around 11.9, it has been a positive return right through. So this statistics, you look at any assembly elections and then look at market reaction, it really does not matter who wins, who loses. India is on a wonderful run for the long run in terms of economic growth. Policies may change. Certain policies may bring in investments in a certain area. Certain sectors could benefit more. But the overall economy would still continue to do well. So therefore, every time you read in newspapers anything about elections, I don't think you should be worried at all. And history shows that. And this is a long history. It's not a short history. And we have seen fairly tough elections, you know, elections where we have seen lot of coalition partners coming together, even coalition partners which on the face of it appear very difficult that they will ever talk to each other. But still the government ran. We have had stints which are very short, like say here 96 to 98 or 98 to 99. Some of them have been long, some of them have been short. It didn't really matter. So this is the reason why we keep saying that in the long run, elections don't matter. What matters is the EPS growth, which goes back to what do companies do, who is buying, what sector is growing, and what is the valuations. Those become the fundamental issues, not whether elections matter or do not matter. This is the same slide where I have put the BSE 30 returns in the context of the real GDP growth. As you can see, at each period, the growth rate on the BSE Sensex have been quite good. From 18.5 in 1980-84 to as recently as 2009 to 2014, around 12.3% CAGR growth. The only period was 98-99 when the markets had declined by 11.9%. This is the chart of the Sensex, the CAGR return of around 16% since January 1980. And again, since January 1980, you know many governments came in, new governments came in place regularly. We have had number of assembly elections. We have had number of central government elections. But markets continue to do well because it'll at the end of the day, it'll look at the earnings power. It'll look at the EPS growth. And that is what will drive the markets. The underlying factor the markets will look at and what we should always be focused on is what are we consuming and whether there is growth in that consumption. As you can see over here, you look at, say, two-wheelers, you look at textile products, cement, home loans, outstanding, all of them have been growing. And we have grown since 2008 when we had the global crisis. So whether there is a slowdown in the Western world or not, there is a basic pattern within India in terms of consumption. There are a lot of young people coming into the job markets. Some get jobs, some become entrepreneurs. There is a need for variety of products. The penetration levels are still very, very low. So therefore, most products will have a huge market in India. There will be cyclicality. It's not that they will only continue to grow. Like in two-wheelers, you are seeing some slowdown now. But those are cyclical slowdown, which happens for a variety of reasons, including adjustment, including need for launching new products, new regulations in terms of energy consumption and emissions. Those will bring about some cyclicality, but the growth rate will continue to be quite strong. So right now, we are consuming close to around 21 million vehicles. You leave aside around 2 million for exports. We have close to around 21 million vehicles is what we continue to consume. And the same trend you can find in cell phone, textile products, cement consumption, as well as home loan outstanding. Over here, you can see that in many products, we are clearly underpenetrated compared to China. And compared to United States, we are way, way, way below in terms of consumption. So whether you look at airfields, you look at the railway number of miles, you look at roadways, there is still a lot of growth opportunities in India. And these are largely infrastructure numbers which I am giving. And then you relate it, once these infrastructure come in place, consumptions will go up. And that is what we need to focus upon, not really worry about the elections and what impact it will have. So this means opportunities for companies, existing companies to grow or new companies to come in and grow. And therefore, we have to go back to check what would be the EPS growth, who will do well, which kind of companies, which kind of managements will do well. And that those are the kind of companies we need to invest. The risk which we see is only the job creation. As you can see over here, we have number of young people. Close to 10 million people are coming into the job market every year. And that, if you really break it down, that works out to close to around 28,000 jobs per day you need to create. Whether it's the government or whether it's the private enterprises, jobs would be the key thing which would be needed. So this is what we mainly tell all our international clients when we talk to all the domestic clients. For us, the risk is not the interest rates. The risk is not the high P ratios where we can sell, we can hold cash, you can do a number of things. The risk for India is really how do we give jobs to these young people, because that can have a lot of impact on social related aspects as well. Barring that, I don't think election is a risk. Election results may make the markets volatile. It's quite possible that they may decline for a day or may go up for a day or two, but it will come back to focusing on EPS and long-term growth. So therefore, any volatility, use it as an advantage rather than worry about whether that will be the case for the long run. It will not. As we have seen over here, we have seen all kind of governments. It will have no impact in the long run. So you have to stay invested in equities. These are certain very long-term charts. As you can see, there, India and China will play a significant role going forward. This was done by Angus Madison from University of Groningen. How India and China was very dominant in GDP way back in 1500, and then how we lost out. And now, given that we have a young population and growing, in the context of world economy, India and China will continue to dominate. And that means opportunities. That means opportunities for enterprises, for profits, as well as people who are invested in the stock markets. We have very young population. There is a huge labor cost advantage compared to the Western world. We are fast transitioning from an agrarian economy to a services economy. And there is a lot of confidence among the young right now. So all of this is what makes us bullish in the long term and makes us less worried about election outcomes and what it will do to the stock market. And these are the few pointers where we carefully look at the market, but the most important one are the bottom two, US Fed interest rates, as well as the young population, whether we give them jobs or we don't give them jobs. That will be the key thing to worry about as far as markets are concerned. So those are some of my thoughts on GDP and markets.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risk. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.